Well, I'm going to begin by asking a terribly boring question, but what's Marco Polo all about and why should we be excited for its release?
Well, I think that one of the exciting things for me is being able to share a Marco Polo story that few people know about. So many people know the mythology about Marco Polo bringing noodles back to the West and the Marco Polo swimming game, but underneath this kind of mythology is a really exciting story. That's a kind of a classic hero's journey story about a young Venetian traveler, one of the first global travelers, who was conscripted into the court of Kublai Khan, the grandson of Chinggis, and trained and groomed as an emissary, agent, and some believe a spy for Kublai Khan. And it is this world of so many colorful characters from different cultures, and set during one of the most turbulent and pivotal times in the history of China. But it's also, as we draw on Marco's accounts, this unique blend of fact and legend. It's a world set in Asia in the 13th century, this exotic, erotic, action-packed world. It's unlike anything on television.
Because, I mean, one of my sort of favourite aspects to Marco Polo is how we kind of explore quite inherent human traits and yet set them in a world that's so far away from our own. Was that part of the appeal, do you think, to audience members? That we kind of, it's all about kind of power and loyalty and sort of various themes we can relate to.
I think we think of Marco as sort of an embedded journalist. He's our eyes into this strange new world. And, you know, he has the distinction of being taken in by this notorious warlord and sort of groomed, you know, to be one of his emissaries. I think just the fact that there's this Western guy in this elaborate Eastern court gives us a lot of opportunities to explore great stories of court intrigue and the whole backstage story of an empire.
I was wondering as well, I mean, it's sort of fascinating to see Netflix release such an ambitious TV series. And I mean, they're starting to have more and more exclusive projects just to them, of course. Do you think this is going to be something that we see more and more of in the future? Do you think this could almost be, to use a cliche, sort of the future of entertainment, you know, to kind of have it consigned to people like Netflix?
I think the idea that a company like Netflix is commissioning content like this is really promising. You know, as filmmakers, it's the greatest opportunity, you know, to tell this long-form story on such an epic scale. And I think they're amazing.
And I was just wondering as well about both of your sort of pre-established knowledge into the world of Marco Polo. Or was this quite something of a learning curve as well for you?
John's the expert.
Yeah. You know, it's my interest in Marco Polo goes back a long way, and in 2007, I was traveling in Mongolia. And parts of China on camel in the Mingxia Dunes, which are the singing sands that Marco Polo wrote about. And then I traced parts of the Silk Road on horseback. And it was during that time that I felt Marco Polo's story needed to be told, and in this new exciting format. I did on-the-ground research in China and Mongolia, but also read multiple translations of Marco's own accounts and cross-referenced with the chronicles of 13th century Persian and Chinese historians, Yuan dynasty histories, and just immersed myself in that world and cross-referenced with the works of other historians. So that was the background that I brought to the original scripts when I started. But then it was, you know, when we started production, the whole group became immersed, and we had consultants from Mongolia and from Beijing University, and you know, not to present it as any History Channel program. This is a really exciting drama and family story, action adventure, but we did have that historical ballast.
And I was wondering, Dan, because you've directed so many sort of huge shows. I mean, not obviously Game of Thrones, Homeland, The Newsroom, sort of True Blood, Ray Donovan. I was just wondering if you think that Marco Polo can reach those heights and that sort of level of success and sort of fan adulation that they've all got.
I've had the good luck to be able to work with very, you know, with great writers along the way in my career, and like David Milch and Alan Ball, and I consider this program to be on a par with those. I was immediately attracted to the writing, to the story, and to the potential of what this could be. So, yeah, I think it's going to be really entertaining. We set out to make something that was unlike anything you'd seen before.
Would you say that this is sort of a golden age for TV? Because, I mean, every year there's just some of the best of TV series ever made are just coming out on a kind of consistent basis.
Yeah, it's funny. I don't think of this as TV anymore. I kind of felt like we were making this big 10-hour movie. You know, because it's on Netflix, it's actually streaming, so it's content. But, you know, I think part of it that's so appealing to me is as a storyteller, it really let us use our imaginations and we didn't have to conform to, like, television formulas. And so that was really a great experience.
So just finally, I mean, obviously, one of the sort of quite interesting aspects of this is that you can watch all 10 episodes in one sitting because it's all being released at the same time. What do you think that brings to the whole sort of experience, the fact that you can finish one episode and just go, right, stick on another?
I think it's, in many ways, it's like the new novel, and that the viewer can determine whether they're going to read 5 chapters or 10. And so it's exciting in that sense.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Hey You Guys!
Hey You Guys, huh?
Hey You Guys.
Is that from The Goonies?
It is indeed, yes.
Nice.
Hey!